Why are you able to shock the God of Thunder? Let's get technical. Even if you're not a Marvel fan, you probably know precisely two things about the character known as Thor. One, hammer. Two, lightning at some point. But despite all of his electrical-based superpowers, movies like Thor Ragnarok establish that Thor is not immune to all forms of electricity. Why, though? Shouldn't his power over lightning make more minor shocks completely harmless? This seems like a valid criticism, but I do think there could be something more technical going on, and the answer may shock you! First, we should understand what Thor is the god of. Lightning is one of the most spectacular phenomenons in nature, a rapid equalization of charge differentials that creates a storm of ridiculous numbers. When negative charges built up in a cloud finally equalize with the positive ground charges here on Earth, a lightning bolt jumps across the sky that's 10 times hotter than the surface of the sun, carrying 100 million volts and traveling at a third the speed of light. It illuminates the night sky with electric fury. Obviously, we know a lot about lightning, but perhaps shockingly, some of it still remains a mystery. For example, we know that the accumulation and separation of positive and negative charges inside storm clouds is where lightning comes from. However, when we measure the magnitude of the electrical field inside of these clouds, we find that mathematically, there isn't enough charge to form a lightning bolt, and yet those lightning bolts happen anyway. So we can't call it magic, and we don't want to, but we can't yet call everything about lightning science. Maybe cosmic rays has something to do with it? In any case, lightning happens, and when it happens to you, it can obviously be very bad. There are five main ways a lightning bolt can potentially be lethal, and the first you're probably most familiar with is a direct strike. However, this is actually the least likely way for a lightning bolt to kill you. A much more likely way to die via a lightning strike is through contact strikes. So for example, if you're holding on to something conductive, and that got struck, and then you got some of that current running through you. You unfortunately hear about this kind of strike all the time when scared livestock bunch up against a metal fence during a storm, and then the fence gets struck and yeah. Another kind of lightning strike that barely scratches Thor and is still more likely than a direct strike is called a streamer, which is an offshoot of the return stroke that travels up into the sky from a lightning bolt, and it kind of just travels through you instead of through the main part of that lightning bolt. Another more likely way than a direct strike is called a side splash of current, like if a lightning bolt struck a tree and then part of that current jumped over into you. But by far, the most deadly form of lightning strike, accounting for over half of all strike fatalities, is called ground current. When a lightning bolt strikes the ground, it doesn't just disappear. Some of that current spreads out in all directions from the strike site, looking for places and things to travel through. If you are too close, you will be one of those pathways it takes. Some of that current will travel up one leg across your body, causing potential death and a lot of damage, and then travels out the other leg. Thor is apparently immune to all lightning-based electrocutions. He gets struck by lightning all the time and shrugs it off. Now, we may not be Asgardian, but when it comes to lightning, humans are pretty resilient too. A lightning strike can kill you. It can blow off your shoes. It can burn your clothes. It can leave you with lifelong chronic side effects. However, your chances of surviving an encounter with lightning are upwards of 90%. Pretty good. When the worst does happen, it's because atmospheric electricity is not just finding its way through your skin and your muscles, it's literally going through your cardiovascular and nervous systems, and it doesn't take that much electric current at all to interrupt your heart and stop it. Knowing the gigantic numbers behind lightning, the temperatures, the voltages, you would expect this survival rate to be a lot lower. Why isn't it a lot lower? Well, thanks to a quirk of physics, the majority of a lightning bolt doesn't go through our bodies. It goes around it. And this may be the reason why Thor can handle lightning, but not an alien space taser. Ooh. Ooh. If Thor was a specific kind of electrical conductor, it could explain this tase of the MCU. MCU Tase 4. No! You have probably heard of AC/DC. before, but in our context, it means alternating current or direct current. Electrical current is the flow of electrons through something like a wire, and when they do that, they can either go in one direction directly or back and forth in alternating directions. AC powers just about everything you can think of, and DC is the power we get from something like a battery. Now, when electrons flow through something like a wire to power, say, the device you're watching me on right now, if we were to cut the wire in half and look for where the electrons are when they're flowing, where would they be? How would they be distributed in that wire? Well, your first guess would be my first guess too, which is they're evenly distributed. They're flowing equally through all parts of the wire, and we would be correct if we were talking about direct current. However, in alternating current, the electrons don't flow like this through the wire. They flow like this. They move themselves as far away from the center as possible and flow along the edges. This is called the skin effect, and it can be so pronounced in some cases that we can make our conductors, like wires, hollow because so many electrons, the majority of them, are flowing along the outside edge.
The shape of this wire kind of reminds me of Loki's horn. He got strangled by an eggplant emoji.
The skin effect could determine what kinds of shocks Thor is safe from. As we've talked about many times on this program, electricity and magnetism are linked, electromagnetism. So when you have a current flowing through a conductor like a wire, that electrical current alone will create an associated magnetic field. If you start changing that electrical current, though, like alternating current does, you will start changing the associated magnetic field. And because a magnetic field can move electrons around, electromagnetism, another associated electrical current is created inside of the conductor. However, these eddy currents, as they are called, flow in the opposite direction. These opposing currents can be crazy strong. Just look at the magnetic eddy currents that are created inside of an aluminum block when someone tries to push it over, move it around inside of a very strong MRI magnetic field. It looks as though it's operating under a different gravity. When all this happens in something like a wire, the eddy currents, just because of geometry, are more concentrated near the center of the wire, which encourages the rest of the current to flow where there's least resistance, around the center, which pushes all of the current effectively towards the outside edges. This is the skin effect, and it turns out that the better the conductor and the higher frequency AC, the more pronounced the skin effect. Nope, not gonna tase me, bro. No, not the hair! Lightning isn't really AC or DC, but its voltages can ramp up so quickly that it can mimic high-frequency alternating current, and therefore lightning has an incredibly large skin effect. This is why when we're struck by lightning, we don't literally explode, and why in a lightning storm, it's a decent idea to stay inside of your car, because if lightning does hit it, it's more likely to go around the metal skin of the car and not directly through it and through you. Keeping in mind everything we just learned about the skin effect, here's what I suggest. Asgardian physiology, or at least Thor's, turns his body into an extremely good conductor that creates a pronounced skin effect when he's struck by lightning. In other words, thanks to Thor's Asgardian skin effect, or tase, almost no lightning goes through his body or his vital organs and is rather routed around his durable armor and his ultra-tough skin, like the chassis of a car, a wide Australian handsome car. If Asgardian skin can protect Thor from lightning with a godlike skin effect, though, the question still stands, why can you shock Thor? We've said taser a few times now, so now let's evaluate the standard handheld taser, which is just the most popular name brand for this kind of electrical weapon. This weapon and others like it are marketed as less lethal because they are designed to run electrical current through muscles and nervous systems to incapacitate humans. Whether by prong or by shot barb, tasers and other electrical weapons deliver tens of thousands of volts of electricity to their targets over microsecond long pulses. Now, the lethality of taser weapons has been a very contentious topic over the years, and so there are a number of studies and papers looking into the effects of tasers on the human body, and I just happen to have found one that answers our question almost exactly. In 2005, professional engineer James Ruggieri published a report called Lethality of Taser Weapons, looking into claims from taser manufacturers that when struck by a taser, targets would be protected by a marked skin effect. In other words, not all the taser voltage would go directly through the body and into vital organs. However, what James found was that the frequency from taser strikes was over 100 times less than would be needed to produce a significant skin effect. There would be no skin effect from a taser, and so taser shocks could easily flow through human biological tissue. Applying all of this to our situation, if a space taser used low-frequency voltages like our own earthly tasers do, then it could theoretically get around a possible Asgardian skin effect that protected Thor from lightning strikes, and it could shock him. Shock him with a space taser. So it doesn't all have to be as simple as Thor is immune to all electricity or he isn't. He could just be resistant to certain forms, which opens him up to be both the god of thunder and shockable. And we already know of real creatures that are this complicated. Electric eels, which are electric but not eels, are known for their ability to generate large amounts of electricity inside of their own bodies, but they're likely not immune to their own shocks. If you were to look inside the body of an eel, you would find muscles and a spinal cord, sure, but you would also find thousands of disc-shaped cells called electrocytes running along its entire body. What these cells do is build up charge inside and outside of them with ions and with chemistry. And then when the electric eel wants to strike, it charges these all at once, releasing them, and then that produces a pretty hefty stack charge that can really mess up a fish. But if the eels are being shocked, they're obviously not being shocked as much as their prey is, and that could have something to do with insulating tissue, the preference for the electric shocks to go into the water rather than into flesh, and maybe the short duration of the shocks. Whatever it is, evolution has prepared these electric eels for a certain kind of shock, but not theoretically all shocks, kind of like we're assuming Thor to be immune or not. So in theory, you could still electrocute an electric eel, but don't try it because ethics. I'm not gonna try it. I'm just gonna slowly walk out. Here, you slimy beast! And if you think about who initially shocks Thor in Thor Ragnarok, things make even more sense. It is none other than a Valkyrie who puts a shock collar on the son of Odin, and she would know his weaknesses, his physiology, who he was. So Thor might be immune to lightning, but not to a Valkyrie with inside knowledge of how Asgardians work and a space taser that is high frequency, low voltage, and specifically designed to shock big old beef muscles into submission. Wow, that thing really makes you a Valhalla, huh? I'm sorry, I love puns. So why isn't Thor immune to electricity? Well, if we combine MCU canon with a bit of physics, we find a situation where Thor can be immune to some kinds of electrical discharges, like lightning with a souped up Asgardian skin effect, but not others, like a low frequency space taser. I know this is all getting kind of complicated, but at least Thor's electric susceptibilities are easier to understand than the endgame timeline. Because science.
Huh? And here's your hammer back.
Thanks. What? There is a weird problem if you are immune to lightning strike, but you want to be a big old glistening MCU beef boy, is that if you have a lot of moisture on the outside of your body, say you're standing in the rain, and you're hit by a direct lightning strike, we know that all the moisture on the outside of your body can flash to steam and blow your clothes off and cause a lot of damage and just be otherwise very bad. So since Thor and every beef boy in the MCU is always glistening, oiled up muscles, a lot of moisture on it, you know, maybe, you know, in the rain, looking all cool. If then he summoned his lightning powers, it would blow his clothes off. Which... Thank you so much for watching, Glenn. If you want more of me, Because Science, or you want to suggest ideas for future episodes, you can follow us here at these social media handles. And go watch the first few episodes of Because Space, and go watch The Science of Mortal Kombat, and have a great rest of your day!